Hey, Remarkable Republican, what are you called on Discord? Just to clarify, so I don't add a rando.
No, add a rando, just let's see what happens.
Random person.
I want to get a random person in, claiming to be Remarkable Republican, to see what they say.
Oh my god, is this actually happening?
He's muted.
This ruins the
bring out the loud soup.
I'm just gonna post memes until he unmutes.
Post memes?
Meme.
This is the internet. You're not allowed to be a
random YouTuber on Twitter. I'm blocking you, Mola. Oh my god, hello.
So, can you hear me fine? Everything's good?
Hello. Yes. How do you do?
Doing alright, man. How are you?
Excellent. I've had many to drink, and I'm jovial with friends. How do you do?
I wish I had had more to drink, but I have not.
So, what did you want to talk about?
Oh, you know, whatever you guys want to talk about. I didn't realize this was a special stream until I got into it, because I didn't see, like, the first few hours, so...
Did you say that you wanted to debate something?
Yeah, I just wanted to, you know, debate a little Star Wars or Game of Thrones or something of that nature that's cool with you guys.
Are you sure that that Leia is best friend hot, rather than just super hot?
I'm 100% positive about that, yes.
What about when she's wearing the bikini?
Oh, that's not too bad, but...
still best friend hot, though.
She should have done that in the other two movies also, I mean...
Sure, I wouldn't have said no to it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, right? I mean, if you know, we're gonna do a...
Personally, revision. I think all of the characters should have... Constantly.
Do you still feel that Vader is a ripoff of RoboCop?
Oh no, I looked that one up. I guess you got me.
So, if you were in a spaceship and landed on Mars and you wanted to go outside, what would you wear?
And you could wear a spacesuit, I guess, right?
I mean, yeah, that would be my choice.
What an odd question, Jay. Why would you ask him that?
Yeah, Jay.
There's context.
Like wellies? What did you think?
Wellies?
<He's> like, wellies. That's the first thing you said. Hey, only wellies.
What was wellies?
Wellies are like big old rubber booties to prevent the mud from getting to your socks.
I mean, yeah, as long as it's somewhat pressurized, you'd be alright.
I don't think wellies are pressurized.
Hey,
okay then.
Just because you say that doesn't mean it's true,
not
Jay.
Not the cheap, shitty ones, but the expensive wellies.
Expensive wellies.
The space wellies.
I'm
imagining someone on Mars wearing wellies, but nothing else.
I imagine C-3PO wearing.
Well, can... Okay, honest question. Can gay people wear wellies?
I don't know what wellies are, so...
Think it's harder.
They are, like, big rubber boots. Without laces or anything. Oh. They just, like, you slip them on for walking in mud.
The kind of rain boots that girls wear.
Oh, yeah, those they're very popular in the UK.
Sure, I guess. I mean...
Let me look through some
of
your recent videos.
Store. If anything you can buy in a store, you can wear.
including macaroni.
What do you
make a whole shirt out of it?
If you only have 1 foot, are you wearing wellies or are you wearing welly?
You're just wearing well.
Do you think it was...
Sounds careful.
Do you think it was a smart decision to put the catapults at the front of the army in Game of Thrones? I mean, the treasure chests, sorry.
Yeah, I do.
Why?
The reason is they assume that the armies of the night would arrive by day, so that way they give you the maximum time and space to fire at them from afar.
But that's not the maximum time and space. They're in the front of the army.
Yeah, but if they're behind the castle walls, they don't have a clear line of sight.
That's if they're behind the walls...
Well, trebuchets don't need a line of sight. You fling it up and over.
Yeah, that's like their advantage is that they don't need a line.
Are you fucking retarded? Do you not know how trebuchets work?
Actually,
don't be so mean to him because he doesn't know how a trebuchet works, okay?
If you fire... I mean, no, I've looked this up. I mean, I've learned a lot of stuff about military things since I did my privatization series, but when you're firing upwards...
We privatize our trebuchet.
Okay, look.
You lose a lot of velocity, so the range you'll have when you're firing and
okay,
how it's remote is not very
okay,
great.
But you realize having them behind the castle walls gives them more range than having them in front closer
well,
to the enemy
big,
army.
The big thing is, right, no matter how much range you gain from putting them at the front, you have zero range when they're destroyed first. It's the army
destroys them. Once the dead close, they're not going to be useful anyway unless you're willing to kill
I disagree.
Why would the zombies arrive by day? Why would they?
Why would they not? There's, I mean, if you think about it,
because their whole thing is night. They paid attention.
Their boss is called the Night King.
I've not seen the show, and I am aware of this.
Also existed during the day. I mean, we see pictures of them during the day. I mean, it's not like
all.
You're right.
If their strategy is to rush the castle with melee weapons, wouldn't it be advantageous to use the cover of night?
Nobody said they exist during the day too.
Not really. I mean, you know, they could fight during night or day. They had a massive advantage. I mean, I guess.
But they were. You're saying that they actually their strategy worked because it was at night.
That helped a lot. I mean, because
so why would they go in the day?
It makes sense that they would do it at night then. Like, it makes perfect sense.
I mean, yeah, if they can plan it that precisely, but I mean, sometimes it's hard to know how long it's going
to take. The night is half of the 24-hour period. It's dark, so
winter is even longer. Like, in fact, it's more
I mean, like, I think one of you guys criticized the fact that they had the Dothraki charge, but I mean, that's how cavalry works.
Yeah, that's
worked.
Retarded.
No, that's not how cavalry works.
Buddy, you don't know anything about military tactics.
No. You don't use light cavalry to start a frontal assault against the enemy.
They literally had no backup or support. They were sent in to die.
Mr. RR, you realize they all died immediately.
They all became zombies!
You're basically just saying, here, have some truth.
They all didn't die immediately because
yes, they did.
The next episode, and there were a lot of Dothraki around.
The show's bullshit. They basically said that they had like more guys than they did.
What are you going to believe, the editing or you're lying?
Why are you posting wellies?
You're going out a very limited line of sight, so we actually don't know if some of them were able to deliver their lances and ride off.
How could they have possibly lived, though? Like, surely they would have come back, you know, the same way that the zombies did, but they didn't. It was just nothing but zombies, so they're all dead.
How many Dothraki zombies did you see?
Dude, they're all dead.
Hold on. Did you miss the part where the Night King raised the dead? And they all stood back up.
But where were the Dothraki zombies? They just rode
they
off.
They were in the crowd that he raised the dead.
They were attacking
from.
Daenerys and all those guys.
Are you trying to argue to us that the fact that they were dead rather than zombies is a win?
I think you guys are overestimating the number of Dothraki who got killed.
I think you're overestimating the amount of functioning brain cells in your empty little head.
Oh, calm down, Wolf. It makes total sense that if... I know it doesn't, but...
Wolf, leave him alone.
Nice.
I mean, how many cavalry charges have you led lately?
How many have you led?
Okay,
so we're on even footing.
So
none
of us can say anything about cavalry charges because we haven't been in them. Is that how it works?
I haven't drank battery acid, but I...
They rely heavily on momentum and space. That's why you have a force, why you have mobility.
Yeah, but what good is that going to do if you're basically running into a brick wall of dead people? It's just a wall of zombies. You're going to die.
They have short swords. All of these
plus, you can't see
cavalry
shit.
Have little short
it's,
swords.
It's pitch black. They don't even see them until they're like a meter ahead of them, and then they're all dead. It's like, what? It was a stupid idea.
You can see all
the
their swords
course
going out.
The better course of action definitely would not have been sending your cavalry in as the front, like the full frontal assault, to die instantly and be used against you.
No. I mean, that's clearly. God, I mean, I think that's clearly the move to make because cavalry just aren't that useful in the defensive. That you have to attack somewhere.
Then don't even use them at all. Then put them like, you know, just put them with all the other dudes.
They didn't wait until the zombies were against the wall, and then they flank from the sides of
like,
the castle.
Basically, this would be. I mean, this would be like if you had people swimming across the English Channel to invade Normandy, and then they all died. And they're like, oh shit! Yes,
I mean, I think you're underestimating how tough the Dothraki are in an attack, but also they can't defend.
They all got killed!
They all died!
How many dead did it take with them? We don't know.
It wouldn't matter because they become zombies anyway!
It doesn't happen until much later in the battle.
Which he could have done at any time at his choosing.
You have no idea if the Night King or any of his subjects raised the dead between that moment and later. You have no idea.
And we know for sure it happened at least once.
Your entire argument rests on the idea that the White Walkers decided not to raise the dead at that point.
I might not have needed to. They seem to have had a lot of numbers going into that.
You're
battle.
Right. You know what? You're right. They had millions anyway. Why even bother?
Who cares? Might need more people.
Because if you can do that at any point, your casualties are irrelevant. You can give the other side a false sense of hope, then raise the dead and be like, gotcha.
A false sense of hope?
The zombies!
Yeah, they were looking really hopeful throughout that.
Why would the zombies want to give them a false
sense of
hope? Let's give them a false sense of hope by giving them loads of free troops and killing loads of our guys.
That is a military tactic, man. You have a bunch of troops to... You have a bunch of dudes surrounded, and you're just like, here, use this gun, go on, I'll give you a sporting chance to kill us, go on, do it. It's like...
The ultimate 40 test tactic is just killing your own troops.
to own the zombie. kill your own troops to own the Sith.
I mean, if you didn't think the dead would get back up, I mean, it kind of makes sense.
They know that they do, though. They know how this works.
Do they all know that? Because
a lot of those guys are like the tacticians.
They literally, it's literally called the Army of the Dead.
They saw it at Hardhome. I haven't even seen the show, and I know that witnessed them raise the dead at Hardhome. He would have told everybody, by the way, they could raise the dead to fight in their army.
I mean, but did he know they could do it en masse, though? I mean,
he watched
I feel like
it happen
kind of
at Hardhome!
Detail.
He watched it! He was sitting there looking
converted the Wildling army, which is supposed to be one of the largest armies in Westeros, into zombies.
I remember that happening.
That sounds cool, I want to watch this film.
I'm gonna go get some more pizza.
You're telling me that you don't remember the one good thing from all of season 5?
No, I guess not. I guess that was what.
Do you remember like? Do you remember like what happened 6 seconds ago? Yeah. Have you ever engaged your brain in your entire life?
Wolf, be nice.
A few times, like when I destroyed you just now on this point about Game of Thrones.
Oh shit! Wolf got destroyed.
Okay.
And also. Like the whole King's Landing battle. I mean, that one actually. I think you guys watched that
what do
one
you
pretty
mean,
bad.
Battle. She fucking wiped out everyone.
There was no battle. It was over. She took out all the crossbows, like just like that, and then it was over.
She made the militarily wise decision to go bold
what,
and
to
go after
kill
all the
kill children. The militarily wise decision to execute
children. She was trying to create a path for her troops to continue to advance.
What? Is that what you think that was?
She burned the city to the ground. Her troops didn't mean
how
anything.
How are you meant to advance through when it's all on fire?
All right.
It's on fire. There's no roads anymore. If anything, you made it way harder to get through.
They literally retreat because the city's falling apart. They have to run away from their own leader.
What's the
thing is, when you're sacking a city, people can knot up in the streets, especially narrow streets like King's Landing. And at that point, then her already depleted forces from the previous battle could take additional casualties. So if you clear the streets by blaming concentrations, it helps.
I need Shadow Visitate.
It wasn't concentrated. It was the whole thing. It was the whole city. She killed everyone. She killed people who were well out of the way of the battle.
I mean, I don't think it showed that many civilian deaths. I think people were reacting
a
little
too quickly. She destroyed the whole city!
The whole city was on fire!
warfare civilians often got killed. It wasn't
that
exactly.
That doesn't mean you go out of your way to kill them.
Hey, they just happened to be in the way.
Yes,
she was mostly going after Lannister
specifically targeted.
She even admits that she killed children in the next episode. What are you talking
she saw
about?
Them. She saw them there, but she still had to clear the street.
She had to clear the street of
children, alright.
She had to clear the street of screaming
no
children.
No women and children would get in the way of the invading army.
I'm sure John was very thankful that those children are out of the
way. I mean, that was the problem with John.
Yeah, we wouldn't want to let those kids get hurt by the
how
army.
How sack worked.
You don't understand how what works, sorry?
I didn't understand how the sack of a city worked. I mean,
buddy,
not
you don't,
men,
I don't think you can tell anyone.
You should be saying right now.
This is
so
amazing.
Like, you know how when Germany invaded Paris, they didn't just kill every single person that was in the city? You know that, right?
Their even mistake, the right?
The city surrendered. Why would
their
they?
Mistake!
Yeah, they surrendered in the show!
Yeah, they surrendered in the show!
She still did it! She's worse than Hitler!
All the troops didn't lay down their arms, though. They were still resisting.
They literally threw down their weapons! That was... I saw that scene.
they literally threw down their weapons and then picked them back up
because they were being melted by horrible fire. I can't believe this is happening.
Well, did Daenerys hear from Cersei that she surrendered? Did Cersei wave a flag on the tower?
The bells! I thought the whole point of the bells
this
was
isn't
we
even
surrendered.
She doesn't have direct access to the bells. How was she going to send a messenger
but
down
the
to the bells?
Surrendered. The city surrendered. She surrendered. What's she going to do? No, I don't surrender
left?
And then die?
She's got her Kingsguard.
She has to get a mobile phone call from Cersei.
Okay, so she's got a Kingsguard, so let's burn all of the children.
That's not what I said.
But like that's the thing. That's the action that she took that you were defending currently. No, when she burned the city.
I don't know if Daenerys heard the bells. Jon heard them, and we know that from the scene. But
she definitely.
She literally. People argue the bells sent her insane. That's what people actually argue.
I don't know how a bell would send somebody insane.
I agree with you. I don't know how bells send someone insane.
Unless that's the first time in her life she's heard a bell, which I find.
What if you'd never heard it? Hang on, that's I really want to question that. Why would that send you insane if you'd never heard a bell before? Like, oh my god,
yeah,
what's
just,
that?
I'm just speculating.
Oh my
like,
god, what is that? I gotta kill
somebody
children.
Would think that, but I mean, I don't know.
All right. All right, I'm sorry.
Well, no, we're shipped there. Top 10.
What a season finale this is.
I'm gonna get another beer.
This is like the end of phase one.
Who knows what phase we're at this point.
Why did you spell in your video Game of Thrones season 8 story arcs like arc as in, you know, like Noah's Ark?
That's how you spell the word arc.
You spelt it ARKS, but you're talking about story arcs, though, right?
Correct.
Yeah, a story arc is not spelt with a K, it's spelt with a C.
Sure, that doesn't sound right.
It's... Hold on.
Yes. Fringy, I love you, man.
I mean, I don't know what to tell you, man. Like, according to Wikipedia, that's how it's spelt. I don't know.
All right.
Well, so, I mean, you got anything to say to me?
Gotta.
Oh, I mean, whatever. It's not that big of a deal.
Oh, God, no. Oh, God, no. Okay.
I think we'll all just be able to mute and Shad can take
this
it.
Be great.
I need this. Please, Shad, pick up the phone.
Who is Shad?
He's kind of an idiot. He thinks he knows shit about medieval stuff. I was going to see if he could talk.
We like to humor him.
Here's the thing. They're all lying. He's your worst fucking nightmare, and I'm gonna love the next 5 minutes.
Why would you say that when he hasn't answered the call yet?
Worst nightmare. Pick up the phone.
Hold on. Can we?
He just wants to drag out the suspense.
I will agree that circumcision is bad, though, so we've always got that.
Who are you voting for in the 2020
versions
election?
Versions of the word arc. Do what?
No, you're wrong, man. Sorry. Like, it's spelled arc with a C. Like, don't...
You saw... Yeah, you sent me the link. I saw it. I didn't know there was another version of the word. I thought it was just...
You mean like Ark of the Covenant?
Everyone's got...
Yeah, that's right.
Everyone's got knowledge gaps.
No, that's fine. Yeah, that's fine.
Wait, hold on.
Survival evolved?
Why is the Outer Worlds cultural Marxism?
The game clearly promotes anti-capitalism, and it does so pretty unapologetically.
How so?
I haven't played it. So.
I mean, so you start out, you're in this world where there is a board of corrupt corporations running everything, and it's basically just all humor about how these companies are evil and how their products suck and how all the people who lead these companies are corrupt and incompetent.
Why is that anti-capitalist by its very nature, though?
And that's literally the only kind of joke that's in the entire thing.
So that can be anti-corruption.
I doubt that that's the only joke in the game.
Being against corruption and capitalism isn't being against capitalism.
It literally is. Okay.
It's a straw man argument against capitalism.
It literally is.
But you're the one interpreting it that way.
Said it was an argument.
What?
I'm just muting myself because I can't control myself.
You fine, Mahler. Hang in there. I'm doing it so you can do it.
None of you guys have played Outer Worlds?
No.
No.
Okay. I feel like I don't need to know that you're not telling me the whole truth. This is what I mean. There's something you're not telling me.
Pretty sure you would agree with me if you played the game. Let me put it that way. I feel pretty confident that
the only jokes in the game are anti-capitalist.
Pretty much. I mean, I'm sure you have an occasional sex joke, but I mean, I played about 5 hours of it, and it was just
You didn't beat it.
The game pissed me off.
The game pissed you off
to where you didn't finish it.
The story was just shitting all over capitalism. I mean, I don't want to sit there and listen to that.
Okay, well, let's actually dive deeper. If the story was shitting exclusively on capitalism, why is that necessarily a bad story?
Because it's a false story. I mean, capitalism.
What do you mean a false story? Stories
aren't real.
Capitalism is meritocracy by its very nature.
Is it though?
No.
Is
yes. it though? No, you can is have no, because you've got nepotism in capitalism.
But there's definitely nepotism in capitalism.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially
I love
in
capitalism,
America. Holy shit.
Yeah, there's a lot that goes on.
Capitalism favors those who are already rich.
But have
well,
you
no,
ever
that's just
seen...
money. That's just money favors those who are always rich.
Well, yeah, that's what I mean. Like
there's money
Let's
in
think about it this way.
Okay.
In the game Outer Worlds, I think they go through 7 or 8 companies eventually, from what I've read in reviews. Would every company be led by someone who is completely and totally retarded?
What do you mean retarded? Are they stupid?
I met the guy
really
in the first village. I met the guy in the first village who was running the cannery, and I mean, this guy was completely moronic. He was unable to run his business. He had let a bunch of people walk out of the camp. He couldn't do anything about them. He couldn't make people work. He couldn't
How does somebody make people work if they don't want to?
I mean, if you're the boss, you figure out how to do that, whether it's through persuasion, force, or whatever you gotta do.
Through force? Force?
Oh, I mean, in this game, yeah. In this game, they own their employees. I mean, if you, you know, you got sometimes you gotta
grab. That's
not
capitalism.
I'm pretty sure that is capitalism.
No, you don't own your workers.
No, but that is still that's still by definition capitalism. It's just not the capitalist system that we use.
Being unable to negotiate your own working conditions.
They did
that's
negotiate
a capitalist.
Those. They signed contracts when they moved to the solar system.
Okay,
so it's indentured servitude?
Right.
I guess you could call it indentured servitude, but I mean, it's a fair price for being transported.
Is
like
it a fair price
to
no longer
man.
Have personship?
I don't think that's fair.
Are there
like how else do you pay for that kind of interstellar travel?
With money.
With money.
With money.
How are you gonna have enough money unless
you have
you're
a job?
Rich? Yeah, you got a job.
Oh,
you
do wow.
Yeah, then
how
by being
you,
rich,
how
yeah.
You do it without money. Wow, that's an interesting commentary on capitalism. Oh, wow. Whoops.
I mean, the last I checked, space travel was not exactly listed as a necessity, was it?
I thought we needed to go to Mars to set up an ethnostate.
Not an ethnostate. Not an ethnostate.
Oh, theocracy. Okay.
An ethnostate would be barbaric and backwards. This is a theocracy.
Well, the only groups that have enough resources to colonize and then the morality to keep a community like that together under harsh conditions probably would be a church organization.
Like Mormons?
Only groups with enough money would be a church.
Like Scientology?
Scientology, like, I mean, in theory, I mean, they'd probably fuck it up, but they, you know, they're welcome
they,
to try.
They would, but you
everyone's
would.
Welcome Zinu to try,
would
man.
Direct them to the light.
Zeno, please. I mean, Zeno will lead us back to the home planet.
There are also a lot of benefits of a space colony that would I don't think you're considering, like especially say for old people who have
no we like space colonies.
No, we don't disagree with the space part.
We like the space colony. Space colonies are a big thumbs up from me.
And for me, I like space.
Yeah, space is fun.
I want me some space.
I saw Ad Astra.
It's the final frontier.
Ad Astra.
Oh, you have an Ad Astra movie review. I haven't seen it. What?
I do.
Do you like Ad Astra? Did you like that?
Oh, wait. Okay. So, sorry. I'm the host. I got to redirect this conversation now. Myself, Jay, Fringy, Rags, Wolf, if we could all stay silent and allow these two gentlemen to talk about.
Right.
Shad, do you remember episode 3 of Game of Thrones season 8? Yes. The castle defense from the army of zombies. Do you remember this?
Oh, yeah, that one, absolutely.
I do
remember this.
I would like, Remarkable Republican, what do you think of the defense of the castle? I'll let you start, and then I will be silent.
I think that the defense that Danny and John mounted was fundamentally sound based on medieval realism. They deployed the catapults forward so they'd have the maximum distance to fire at the approaching enemy. They were assuming the enemy would arrive by day. They sent the cavalry to charge because the cavalry needed space and momentum to be effective. So their opening moves were solid. They also divided their defenders between outside the castle walls and inside, so that we were defending all parts at all times. I don't see how they could have done much better than what they did. They also had their dragons doing close air support and looking out for the other dragons. So I feel like they mounted a pretty competent and respectable defense.
Do you know what castles are meant to be?
Yeah, they're forts.
Also, cavalry. When is it preferable to use cavalry in open warfare?
100% of the time.
No. Battle of Agincourt, massive French cavalry charge got absolutely wiped out by English archers. There are many situations. No, there are many situations when cavalry is a terrible idea. And the situation when they were used in Game of Thrones is most definitely one of them.
Well, the dead didn't have archers, though, so it's not Agincourt.
No. But see, the other situation, cavalry primarily is used for shock tactics, hopefully to try and break up a unit formation. And you want to get them to flee. If they don't flee and they storm the cavalry will be dead. And so after the first impact, if the infantry isn't breaking up, the cavalry needs to retreat. Otherwise, they're going to get mowed down. Now, with an army of the dead, do they retreat?
That I'm aware of.
No, the army of the dead don't retreat. And they were also outnumbered as well. The other time when you can use cavalry to just really mow down infantry is if you are outnumbering them in a large measure. You have a lot more cavalry. But even then, that's not a guaranteed thing. It always needs to be used with the right, you know, reason and consideration and stuff like that. But in regards to the Game of Thrones situation, the cavalry was outnumbered and the undead won't retreat. And so sending them in is utter and complete suicide, especially looking at it from the historical lens of what cavalry is meant to do and when they're meant to be employed.
And Shad, are there different kinds of cavalry?
Oh yeah, light cavalry, heavy cavalry, and stuff like that. And what's interesting about the Game of Thrones thing, technically the Dothraki are light cavalry, and so that is like to use light cavalry in a heavy frontal assault charge into infantry like that is absolute, just completely retarded because they're not unarmored. Sorry, they're not wearing heavy armor to survive the melee that they're running into. They don't have lances, so there's no insta-kill on the direct hit impact. They are armed with like small sickles and stuff like that, which means they can't strike anyone in front of their horse, okay? Yeah, can only strike people with these type of weapons on the sides of your horse, which means you can't remove or attack anyone in front of you, and so you're just presenting your horse to be killed in that way.
Don't you think you might be underestimating the skill of these guys who have been kicking so much ass? in the show.
So they're superhumans?
And they were dominating in Essos.
Probably because they were being used in the right way, as light cavalry should be. Skirmishing, harrying around the edges and stuff like that. There was also a lot of mounted archers with the Dothraki, if I recall. And again, just like the Mongolians historically, light cavalry, you run around it. And like, if you look at history, there were actually some interesting engagements between the Mongolians and Eastern Europeans. You can kind of call them knights, but not, but anyway, armored, you know, European, very medieval kind of combatants. And they got absolutely mowed down by the Mongolians because the Mongolians were employing their light cavalry to just perfect, you know, just in a perfect amount. And it was basically running around them, pinging them from a distance, not running into heavily armored units.
I mean, the only weakness of the Mongols historically is if they'd ever run across real European knights. I mean, there's no way in hell they could have gone up toe-to-toe with, like, Richard the Lionheart or, like, a really
The Mongolians trashed the Europeans when they, like, we're talking about mounted, you know, units. Whenever they engaged, they won. Like if you're looking at from the medieval technological standpoint.
Also, have you ever seen a picture of the Mongolian Empire and how far west?
Yeah, they went into Russia.
They were they were past Russia. They were almost at Constantinople. I mean, they were pretty far west.
And they didn't conquer anywhere where they had true knights.
Dude,
though.
They weren't in
France or Germany.
No, you would call them true. Well, hang on. How do you define true knights? So you're talking about heavily armored cavalry, because Mongolians did defeat heavily armored cavalry.
Lance, sword, and
the Mongolians did defeat heavily armored cavalry. It's historical. It happened.
Were they knights?
How do you define knights?
You have to have the equipment, and you also have to have a code of chivalry.
How do you define the code of chivalry?
It's the code of chivalry. It's just like the code of conduct that they all follow. I mean, it's the thing that makes them who they are. It's their moral
code.
Well,
I mean, do you think that every kingdom had the same code of chivalry for every, you know, knight group that they had? Why are you conflating, like, all of Europe as though it's the same?
Fring is actually completely right here. Chivalry was a subjective thing interpreted by the knights, and its most accurate application is chivalry means the qualities that make a knight good at his job. And it started with pure horsemanship, because chivalry comes from the word chevalier, and if you go back, it basically translates to horseman originally. And so if you were good at horse riding, or technically combative horse riding, you were chivalrous in the original genesis of the word. And as it evolved, it simply expanded to mean the qualities that made a knight good at his job. And when you look, I made a whole video on this, all right? Like, chivalry is one of my specialties. And when you go back and actually look at how chivalry was interpreted historically, there was never a codified, unified thing that everyone followed. And there were forms of chivalry that one person would call chivalrous and another group of people would think that's completely incorrect, and their version of chivalry would outrightly contradict something. Sorry about the kids in the background, by the way. Yeah. And so following chivalry, like, is a very essential part of what defines, you know, a knight to be a knight, but not necessarily means that they're going to be better at mounted combat than many other people of the medieval period. And the type, it doesn't make their type of mounted combat different from other heavily armored, mounted, you know, warriors who were not knighted of the period. Okay. And so when you're looking at heavy cavalry of the medieval period, the fact that one group might be knighted and one group might not be won't change how effectively that you could employ them in combat, is my point.
Similarly, like, the skill of the Dothraki, for instance, won't change that little sickle into a lance.
Yes, yeah. That's correct.
I mean, to circle back, something you said stuck with me. So you said that the code of chivalry was subjective. So were the knights like some sort of postmodernist or something? I mean, that doesn't
postmodernist.
Well, can you connect those dots for me?
What?
I
Where's your connection there? I'm genuinely interested.
I mean, because I thought chivalry was supposed to be an objective code of conduct, like kind of.
No. The big problem that you have is that you're assuming that all of Europe is like the same, and that they all believe the same things and all held the same code of conduct. Like Europe is not like America; it's a whole bunch of different countries.
Thank God.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. I mean, when you look at the actual books written of chivalry, like. There's one written by Chrétien de Troyes, and then there's, I have all the references in my video and stuff like that. They are trying to describe how they feel a knight should act, which is actually a direct kind of point of reference to show that not every knight was behaving the way that they felt they should, otherwise there was no point in them even writing their books in the first place, all right? And so, another one was by Raymond Lull, okay? So chivalry meant many different things depending on how the different areas, knights and even lords, felt what made a good knight. And if you did those if you perform those qualities that the individual lords or even the individual knights felt made a knight good at their job, they were then chivalrous by these individual definitions.
Okay, I think I got you.
So they're not, do you still think they're postmodernists?
I didn't realize there were different codes of chivalry. I mean, that's not really something that pops up.
Well, I mean, did you really think that like British knights had the same code as French knights and why would you think that though?
Yeah, that's a huge misconception. There was no unified code of chivalry that everyone was forced to adhere to.
I mean, it sounds like you think that there was like some rule book on society, you know, like a society rule book that's like you do like this.
I mean, that's what I thought.
Like special night laws.
Nah.
So you're wrong on that one then, right?
I guess I was. So, all right, cool. What was it that made someone like, say, a Richard Lionheart or like some of the other really really good knights? What was it that made them so good? What was their secret?
Generally success.
I mean, what led to success?
What do you mean? Like, in terms of success in combat? So like, you know, one of the more successful knights was William Marshall, and he gained huge fame from winning many tournaments, you know, jousts and all that stuff. But as to active service in large wars and stuff, he had some military service early on, but not to the scale of, say, Richard the Lionheart. And if you want to look at some of the things that certain kings who were lauded at being very noble and chivalrous, some of the things they actually did in warfare, by the romantic view of chivalry, they would seem like massive villains. Richard the Lionheart executed a few hundred prisoners or so because Saladin was stalling and didn't pay certain ransoms. And so because the ransom weren't paid, yeah, he executed them all. Might not seem very chivalrous. Knights, and especially kings, when it came to warfare, were actually far more pragmatists than they were, you know, I shall not fight, on unfair grounds and stuff like that, you know. They were warriors, first and foremost, and they did adhere to the things that they felt were chivalrous, but and also generally their direct society, but kings, more so than anyone else, had the power to go against the grain and do whatever the hell they wanted because not many people were going to challenge them.
Did you know that Richard the Lionheart was gay? Fun fact.
What was that, Rags?
King Richard the Lionhearted was gay.
So was Dumbledore.
Can we go back to Game of Thrones and how terrible episode 3 was? Republican man, what did you think about the trebuchets being at the front of the lines? What do you think about that?
I think that gives you the maximum distance to bombard the enemy before they close with you, and so that's the best place to put them. Then ranks
how long, how long does it take to reload a trebuchet?
I would estimate around 30 seconds, somewhere around there.
30 seconds? And how long does it take to readjust where a trebuchet is being aimed at? Like in terms of the the range, because the range is determined by the counterweight, and so the weights that you put in the counterweight on the trebuchet. And so if you are facing an army that's charging you, and that means their position is in a constant state of flux because they are charging you, you're only going to get one shot of the trebuchet, and so you have to reconfigure the whole setup to try and figure out where the enemy is in already, and by that time the enemy will have engaged. You do realize trebuchets were rarely ever used by a defending army historically. They were mostly always used by a besieging army, usually against fortifications, a castle. The main reason why? Castles don't move.
Well, yeah, I mean, so, I know that they were mostly used to bust walls, but I guess they're pretty good at killing personnel, though.
In defense against an attacking army, rarely ever used, okay? And if you did use them, well, one, you would most definitely want to put them behind a protective wall. Otherwise, they're just destroyed.
A good example would be the Battle of Minas Tirith, where both the orcs were using trebuchets to try and break sort of the castle defenses, and they were using trebuchets against a giant army, but they didn't put the trebuchets in the field because, exactly. If you put them in the field, then it's like a couple minutes and then they're gone.
Yeah. By the way, and there were also trebuchets and catapults in the Long Night.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I have another whole video on catapults. That catapults were not employed nearly to the level that people assume in medieval combat. You know, the trebuchet meme, it truly is the more superior siege weapon. And also, just to your point about putting the trebuchets out in front, how far out in front of the walls was it? Like, only, was it 50 meters in front of the
I don't think it was very far, because you can see, I think you can see the castle like in the frame as well.
Yeah.
So if the dead are afraid of fire.
So
and,
this is the thing. So if you're putting the trebuchet, 50 meters in front of the castle walls and the dead, how long would it take them to charge over 50 meters?
Probably like 10 seconds.
10 seconds?
50 meters, let's say 45 seconds.
I mean, that's pretty slow, man, I think. Like, 50 meters.
They are zombies, though.
With the length of time that it takes to reload a trebuchet, especially...
Just one thing. The zombies are very fast. I want to clarify that.
Yeah, yes, they are very fast.
And with the length of time it takes to reload a trebuchet, and by the fact you would need to recalibrate it so it would be shooting at a shorter distance by removing things from the counterweight, you wouldn't get an additional shot off by moving it forward by 50 meters. The few seconds that you're gaining won't do a thing. You would still get the same amount of shots from the trebuchet, whether it's in front, forward like that, or behind the walls.
I mean, I guess the question, Republican, is like, if you, in the battle of, I keep referencing fantasy battles, but like, in the Battle of Helm's Deep, they didn't put like anything in front of the wall. Because, like, the wall, they were going to reach the wall eventually, so anybody that you put there is dead. They're
so the trebuchet
dead.
Couldn't stand on the terrain in front of Minas
Well,
Tirith.
Yeah, so are you leading me to believe that if it could stand there, they would have put it there?
I mean, possibly.
You think they would have, though? Like, you really think that?
I mean, I don't know what the rules of the Lord of the Rings universe are.
What do you mean the rules?
It doesn't matter.
They want to kill him.
I don't know if Tolkien was quite as versed in medieval things as George R. Martin is.
It wasn't George's decision to put the trebuchets forward like that. It was the showrunners. Because George is pretty well versed in medieval stuff.
Yeah, he would have put
the trebuchets out in front of an army like that.
Do you guys actually believe that the showrunners just like totally did what they wanted and ignored George R. Martin?
Yes.
How would they get away with that once he publishes the book, though? Because there's no way
they don't give a shit. They've already made their money.
What do you think is going to happen to them?
You think season 8 is the first time they deviated from the books? It's not.
I've never read the books, but this is the first time I've heard.
Did you know that the show is ahead of the books right now?
Yeah,
so they've definitely deviated from the books then, because the books don't exist.
Right, but I imagine they still have an outline to work from, and they're probably following it because they know how dedicated Game of Thrones fans are to keeping with
what
they
Martin figured wants. That out really quick.
Hang on. Your argument was how would they get away with it? They haven't got away with what they did do. Like, they haven't.
Everybody's really pissed
off. Everybody's really annoyed at them.
Yeah, like season 8 is gonna go down in the annals of history as some of the worst,
possibly the worst media that ever fucking got shat onto our TV screens.
I mean, if you guys think that's the worst thing that's ever happened, I have to wonder if you guys have ever seen things like the Funky Phantom. And
In reference to how it started, it is the worst. Yes,
it is among the worst. It is certainly in terms of cultural relevance and significance and its popularity.
It's definitely important, like, up there. The perspective, right? Because it's the final season of a show that was widely regarded to be of very high quality, and yet it's so amateurishly written, like. I mean, you've already conceded the cavalry point. I'm not sure why you're still arguing about the trebuchets and that if the Battle of Helm's Deep was happening, that they would put the trebuchets in front of the wall.
Well, just from the things that we mentioned, you would concede that putting the trebuchets forward like that is just retarded. It was never done historically. And the fact that they did in the show was just stupid.
I love you, Shad.
But do we know with 100% certainty that trebuchets work the same way in Game of Thrones as they work in
the world? How would they work any differently?
They have
trebuchets.
But what? But they're showing us a trebuchet. The assumption is
trebuchet. You got dragons, but like gravity works the same way in Game of Thrones.
It was a counterweight trebuchet. They showed it as a counterweight trebuchet with no deviation from the historical versions.
Mm-hmm.
R2, the point that one of the big issues here is that you want to protect your siege equipment for as long as you can so that they have enough time to continuously fire at the enemy.
It's not how it works, it's what it does, and it showed it, I assume, I've not seen it, it showed it doing the same thing that a trebuchet does. That's how everyone knows it's a trebuchet.
And even in the show,
if we look at the assumptions we've made, I mean, obviously the dead, they just make attacks, they don't defend. They have no castle, so you can use your trebuchets. You can sacrifice them if you want to. What good are they going to do?
Or you could keep them behind the walls and use them multiple times. I mean, even in the show, they only get one shot off before the dead overrun them, don't they?
I mean, that would be considered a complete... Imagine you had an M1 Abrams and it got blown up after firing one shot. It's like, well, shit, that's like $20 million down the drain.
And Shad, I looked this up real quick. Maybe you can confirm. Someone asked, what is the rate of fire of a typical medieval counterweight trebuchet? This gentleman says that the larger counterweight has a record load time of 4 minutes and 20 seconds.
Load.
420.
That sounds about right.
About right. So,
one shot, maybe.
Now, video games can help us contextualize this a bit better. But 4 minutes and 20 seconds is an eternity.
In a battle,
every second counts.
Yeah, with a charging enemy, with the length of time it took for the dead to close the distance, and it's funny because out of all the mistakes they made in that show, the fact that the trebuchets only got one shot off before the dead closed the distance does sound want to be one of the only accurate things, which just goes to emphasize the point even more that if you were going to use them, you would put them behind the bloody walls of your castle. Mm-hmm.
Shad, what about the putting your men outside of the castle walls?
Well, even that is stupid as well. the amount of spare, like in my review, I said if they had any spare space inside the castle, there should be filled up with, you know, those men armed
and
they have tons of space in there. It was. I was shocked at how much space was inside the castle after the dead actually got inside. I couldn't believe it. They should have loaded up that castle shoulder to shoulder with their soldiers, obsidian tipped arrows, even fires, whatever, as many as they could. And then if they couldn't fit everyone in after they loaded it up as much as possible, you wouldn't position your military in front of the castle. You would put it to the flanks, the sides of the castle, and you would get the army of the dead to hit the castle forward front on, smack them against the walls, and then you would close in with the infantry on the sides and flank them in that end. And then if they start to actually focus on the infantry instead of the castle, you would get the infantry to retreat, move around the castle, get the dead to follow them while the defenders on the walls of the castle just ping them off, okay? Mm-hmm. And that's how you would work it. And so the dead, that would either force the army of the dead to split their forces to focus on the infantry in the castle at the same time, or they would commit all their forces to attacking the castle or the infantry. And if they're doing that, when the army of the dead is attacking the castle, you get the infantry to smack them. And then if the army of the dead is attacking the infantry, you get the castle to smack them.
And you know,
I do have one problem with that.
like cavalry could come in handy in a situation like that once or twice.
Oh, absolutely, because as soon as you have, you know, the army of the dead engaged with something, okay, you then bring in the heavy cavalry to do a massive shock impact on their flanks, okay, because that's not that those are the positions in which they're not ready to receive an attack on, and the cavalry would be employed to a much, much better degree. But with the Dothraki, because they're light cavalry, you don't send light cavalry into the ranks of your enemy, okay? You use them to harry the enemy. Because they got swords, you run up on the sides, slash, and then withdraw, and then run in again, okay? You don't charge in unless they're dedicated heavy cavalry.
There's one problem with the scenario you're painting, though, and that's that they don't have enough provisions to maintain everybody within the fort. So if they all get in the walls, then they're just going to be starved out.
How many provisions do they have?
Did the army of the dead wait to starve them out?
No, but they could. The Night King could just be like, oh, these guys fucked up. They're cut off.
They didn't.
Also, where are you drawing information that they didn't? But also, where's your information that they didn't have enough provisions for the army?
You just moved a massive number of men to a single point in a short period of time.
Don't you think they would only do that if they had the supplies to do it, though? Doesn't that make more sense?
Well, no, here's the bigger fundamental problem. Like, they obviously have enough food for everybody there because they're all there. Like, what are you suggesting? That when you put them outside, they don't have to eat and drink? Like, they're just going to stand there forever?
No, your supply line's open to the south where you can import more food.
So why does that change if they're outside the walls?
Because if they're not, if they don't have a supply line that they have to maintain outside the walls along the road.
Why wouldn't they just leave then? But they can, what's stopping them from leaving the castle?
So a couple of things, okay? If the Army of the Dead didn't attack, that would have worked in their favor because they got two dragons that they can just go in, destroy them, and hopefully draw out their dragon, and then draw them back to the castle and take out the dragon. But the fact I was annoyed that the dragons weren't used nearly to the level that they could have been, because they were massively effective. And you know, you could say, oh, but the Night King and his lances and stuff like that is like, yeah, that's very convenient to the plot. He's only good at it when he needs to be and stuff like that. But it's not necessarily the win move for the Army of the Dead to wait. There wasn't really much indication in the show to say that they would wait. But having said that, waiting is still a good strategy. That's what the whole point of a siege is to starve them out. But it almost seems like the Army of the Dead wouldn't have been doing that. They were marching forward. They wanted to penetrate deeper into Westeros. And to do that, they needed to get past Winterfell. I didn't see much indication that they had that level of patience.
Well, yeah, because if the idea is that they could go around Winterfell, then why even, like, battle them there? Just, like, go around.
I mean, that would be an idea, draw them out of their fort.
But surely it's not an idea to go around, because they had to go through.
I mean,
you see, when you have a castle, if you have the supplies, and there seems to be plenty of indication that they did, waiting actually it goes in your favor, because it gives you time to rally more defenses.
Game of Thrones lawman here. They want to kill Bran. That's their main goal. Bran is hidden inside the castle. They're assaulting the castle to kill Bran.
Oh,
they
so
want
they're
Bran.
Not going
to
wait him out then?
No, they're not going to wait whatsoever. They're going to assault as soon as possible.
Well, there you go.
I mean, do we know for a fact that their main goal was Bran? I mean, because we know that was...
Yes, we do.
Yes.
The final scene where they all crowd around Bran while the Night King waits to execute himself. That was their only goal. They didn't care about anything else. They were going to kill everything in their way.
How did they just not attack the garden directly, then?
Exactly. You're just highlighting even more issues with this show.
Yeah, the Godswood should actually be behind inside
all
the
they needed to do
Winterfell.
Is have the dragon do a suicide run.
I actually have another whole video on how Winterfell should look according to the books. Mm. There you go. Another also deviation as well from the shows and the books. The Godswood should be
all I'm looking for, R2, is that you'd agree that it's not very well written, episode 3 of season 8 of Game of Thrones. What do you think?
I mean, I thought it was pretty well written.
But
Has Shadiversity changed your mind whatsoever?
I mean, he showed me that there are differences between real medieval war and Game of Thrones.
Can you tell me why those wouldn't apply to Game of Thrones?
Wow.
Well, I mean, I don't think it necessarily makes the story bad, because the story is primarily about story arcs, which I guess you guys must not have watched a more recent video on story arcs, because the point is
story arcs built with a K. Yes, that video, right?
Sure. I mean, So, okay, I spelled arc wrong. You got me on that, but I already admitted that.
But hang on. The combat, the fighting, the strong points of conflict, they create and are an integral part of the story arc overall. You just can't separate them.
They absolutely are, because they're
a vehicle of storytelling rather than
They're a faulty vehicle. They're a flawed vehicle. So, imagine that a story is like a car, or the story is, the beginning and end of a road, and the car is like the vehicle for the story. So the plot is like the chassis, the characters are the wheel, let's say the world is the wheels. So every time you get something wrong, you're basically slashing the tires of that car and making it harder and harder to get to the end point, in a smooth, good way. Yeah, it gets bumpier, it starts to drag. We're talking about
specific characters, though. I mean, I actually thought...
No. Everything is part of it. You can't compartmentalize it. Prioritize what you think is more important, for sure, but, the world is really important, especially in speculative fiction.
If how you arrive at your theme or goal or purpose, whatever you're trying to achieve in a story, if you arrive at that using means that are nonsensical, contradictory, have plot holes in them, are inconsistent, then that is bad storytelling. You just want the reward without putting in the work and without making the effort to have it all make sense. If you needed to have the good guys win in the Battle of Winterfell, they were just about to lose, but then the fucking Marines arrive in their tanks and their M16s and they blow away all of the undead and they save the castle. Oh, we got our arc finished for the characters. We won the battle. We saved the day. But how we got there was completely nonsensical.
I guess that would change all of Game of Thrones into a comedy.
Oh, a lot of people have been laughing at it, for certain. But
it would ruin the story.
Yeah.
Okay.
A world should abide by its own rules and its own internal logic. Same thing with Star Wars and Warhammer and Mass Effect. And every fictional world has a grounding in some set of rules that it follows. That helps establish stakes. That helps let the audience know that not literally everything is possible. Even Harry Potter has rules. And that is...
That's the big thing, right? Is making sure that people know that not everything is possible. That there won't be any...
then there's no stakes.
Stories, exactly. Because stories are built on expectations to some extent. And that means, even if the story does something that you didn't expect, it has a logical through line, so that there, it would be reasonable for you to expect that. Whereas, it would be unreasonable for me to expect that if I were watching episode 9, that Palpatine wasn't dead and he's actually coming back and he's gonna fight Rey, and that's gonna be the end of the series.
I mean, I don't know what'll happen in episode 9. I don't think anyone does, but
yeah, we do. I think we know what's gonna happen.
I think
we know exactly what's gonna happen.
Yeah,
we
the know. Leaks have been extensive and ongoing to a degree I've never seen before.
Yeah, it's kind of unbelievable.
Yeah, it is legitimately interesting.
Do you think it's all just a big fake out by Disney?
Why? What would they have to gain?
What do you mean?
I mean, do you think they're just trying to get one over on the fans by
letting people make money? I'm going to use my host powers here. I feel like the conversation has reached a natural end. I want to refocus the stream as to what it was originally intended to. I appreciate the discussion with both Shadowversity and Remarkable Republican, but I was going to say
Mahler, yes. I don't know if you're going to dismiss him or so we can get along, but he has to ask him the episode 9 question.
I will do that. Okay. Remarkable Republican, who do you think, and I'm going to rephrase this question because I don't exactly know how you feel about Star Wars, who do you think is going to be the character that's treated the worst in terms of consistency in episode 9? Who do you think is the character that will fail to live up to who they are intrinsically with what we understand about them in episode 9, from what we understand? And this is based on absolutely anything. Who do you think?
If Palpatine comes back, it'll be him. Because
oh shit, we disqualified Palpatine.
Yeah, oh yeah. This was this poll, we're keeping track. We just want to see who gets it right. So before we began, we didn't know that Palpatine was going to be in this one. So we've disqualified Palpatine and I think Lando.
Yes.
Yeah, Lando is disqualified.
Just yes. give us your top three, I guess, and then we'll be able to tell you sort of how it works out.
Well, I guess no matter what Rey does, it isn't really a surprise at this point because she kind of just does whatever. Finn has been super inconsistent, but I don't. The Asian lady that everybody hated, they'll probably make her do something that makes no sense again. If Leia's in the movie at all, I mean, that wouldn't make sense. I don't know.
She's
I don't
in
know
a lot
what
of
it.
Why would you?
No, no, Jad,
the emotional core of the film.
Who do you think will be the one that's treated the worst? Go for it.
Worst. Okay. I'm going to go with Kylo Ren.
All right.
Because
we disqualified Kylo Ren.
We disqualified him too. You got to pick someone else.
Okay. All right. Poe Dameron.
All right. That's fair. There you go. What's your reasoning for Poe Dameron out of curiosity?
I couldn't choose Kylo or Palpatine, but also they just made him. In the last episode, they kind of emasculated him. So I don't know what he's going to do now, but it won't be something that you would expect out of a fighter pilot. It'll probably be something really dumb.
Yeah, all right.
Seminars about feelings or something.
Yes, fair enough. There you go. Every person who comes on EFAP and is considered a relatively full-time guest is given a chance to answer this question. So thank you for giving your input. Is there anything else you'd like to say before you you hop out?
Not really, just thanks for having me on. Had fun talking to you guys. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already.
Remarkable Republican, you can find him on YouTube. He makes a lot of videos about Game of Thrones and assorted other medias.
I know, it was good to meet you, mate. I know it was a bit of a strange way to meet and everything. I just enjoy a good, you know, healthy debate. So sorry if I come off a bit aggressive at times, but I'm just like...
Excellent.
It was good to meet you, Shad.
Yeah, good to meet you too, man.
Because it's just, I don't mean to rush, it's just that we've got intention with this stream. So, yeah, thanks for coming on, my good man, and perhaps we shall see you in the distant future.
All right, well, have a good night, guys.
Thank you very much. See you around.
Bye-bye.
See ya, man.
Bye-bye.
I haven't had a headache that intense since the first time we covered Bob.
I enjoyed that immensely.
I love that. Thank you very much, Shad, for... coming on.
Thank you for saving us.
Hi. So that was, hooray. That was everything I thought it would be.